So I have five pieces. I will just mention them and ask if any questions about these cases. So case one, the decision, it includes the decision regarding chocolate cysts, especially if follicles were not visualized at the beginning of the simulation. And the protocol used was agonist-stop antagonist protocol. So if there is any opinion about other options, calculation of the initial dose in this patient, especially considering the fact that the follicles were not seen and she was obese, and we have to depend only on AMH and the time to pregnancy and its effect on pregnancy outcome. So as regards the management of endometrioma in IVF, of course, removal of endometrioma before ICSI does not improve live birth, or doesn't improve clinical pregnancy rate. Stop GnRH agonist protocol combined with multiple dose GnRH agonist. On 2011, there was a meta-analysis that showed stopping the agonist does not add to the protocol, but a recent article showed that as a proof of concept, that stopping the agonist in low responders could have some benefit. As regard obesity and BMI, women with high BMI have lower responses. This is controversial, of course, and they have higher gonadotropin requirements. And this has been shown in several papers, and other experts show express different opinion. Now, as regards the fact that the follicles were not seen, we had to depend on AMH, and there are papers that depended on AMH that showed that AMH can be divided into three categories, and these categories determine the gonadotropin dose used. And if the AMH was more than 3.3, the dose of AMH used was 150, and if it is from 1 to 3.3, the dose was 225. So the results regarding whether to use AMH or antrafollicular count for personalization of the dose showed that both have the same impact on dose determination. Time to pregnancy is affected by BMI. Time of pregnancy is also affected by the presence of fibroid plus other things. And also time to pregnancy affects the outcome of pregnancy. It can increase the incidence of abortion, and also it can increase the incidence of, this is the first case. So the patient is 27, BMI is 38, primary 5 years. She has bilateral chocolate cysts, large chocolate cysts. AMH is 2.8, antrafollicular count could not be seen, and the protocol used was agonist stop protocol. These are the chocolate cysts. All oocytes had central darkness, but during injection, they were completely normal tinting, and no degeneration. On day three, we have adequate number of embryos, and 7 4AA blastocysts were developed on day five. And two blastocysts were transferred. And the transfer was done based on predetermined measures. The transfer was determined, was done based on predetermined measures in which we measured the length of the cervix and the length of the uterus, and then subtract one from these whole measurements and put the embryos without ultrasound guidance. And the patient was pregnant. So
we discussed every case. by case, and I think in this case, me personally have to ask you why you choose the Amnesty Stop protocol in such a case. Because most of us don't use this protocol in the closest patient. And,
it's a good question. And the agonist protocol synchronizes follicles. The long agonist protocol synchronizes follicles. The stop of the agonist, because I didn't know whether the patient will be a poor responder or not, I couldn't see any follicles. So I stopped the agonist in order to stop the direct effect of the agonist on the ovaries. And when I had a response on the as follicles appeared on the ovary, I used the agonist again.
Okay, and you don't prefer to use builds and antagonists before, huh?
Of course, this is another option.
Okay, for the way you transfer, you don't prefer to use ultrasound during. I think if you use ultrasound, abdominal ultrasound, isn't it better to make sure that you are okay?
Of course, using ultrasound in abdominal ultrasound to transfer is the gold standard practice, but this needs a very good machine and it needs an expert to hold the abdominal probe. So you have two operators. It takes time, the bladder is full, the patient is irritable. And for me, I think that the most important point is to put the droplet in a specific distance from the tip of the endometrial stripe. So if you can put it by whatever means, then it doesn't matter. What do you think?
I agree with you, but I think if you can add, for me, if I add the abdominal ultrasound and it helps me, okay. But I agree with you, if it takes longer time, I usually go back to my measurements and this will be a better outcome than spending time and losing the good or optimum time for embryo transfer.
Yes,
so I strongly agree with you for measuring first, but if you can add the abdominal ultrasound, I think.
What is the point of using ultrasound, Ashraf? The point of using ultrasound is to put the droplet on a specific distance from the tip of the endometrial stripe. Is that correct?
That's correct, and I think it is assuring for the patient, and I think it is more compliant. You can see the transfer with more confidence. So if it helps us, no problem. But if it started to distract us, okay, I agree with you. Okay. And maybe the last question in this case about I'm strongly proud of this number of blastocysts 48. I think this is an excellent result from the lab for such patients and for such quality of embryos. And so this is very good.
Thank you. I think also one of the most important point is that we could not see the ovaries at the beginning. So we counseled the patient that we will not do cystectomy and we'll try stimulation first. And if we could not visualize the ovary, then we may speak about cystectomy because it affects the ovary reserve. And despite the lack of any follicles appearing at the beginning, a lot of follicles appeared afterwards that resulted in the good embryos that you referred to.
And for me, I think in a lot of time, you can observe those patients with abdominal ultrasound. It is not so difficult if you try abdominal ultrasound, especially after the follicles got higher diameter, I think it will help and there will be no problem. Okay. Can we move to the second case, please?
So the second case discusses the impact of 2X failure, the impact or the use of long protocol for Poseidon 2, the use of 225 units for Poseidon 2 with 2 failures, the criteria for HCG and the number of embryos for transfer, and the transfer technique has been already mentioned before. So Poseidon 2 is an old patient with good reserve that had less than 4 oocytes. that had less than 4 oocytes in an attempt before, that's 2A, or had 4 to 9 oocytes in attempt before, this is 2B. And Sankara this year present show in a publication showed that the option for downregulation in Poseidon 2 is either the long protocol or antagonist protocol, and the dose of granthropine is higher FSH over the standard, that over the standard 150 to 225. So she advised of a higher dose, and the addition of LH in this protocol is optional, and the trigger HCG for the agonist protocol and agonist for the antagonist protocol. And of course, as our guests mentioned, the due stem for those patients is not also a bad idea. So the guidelines as regards the time of trigger mentioned that follicular size is important, but it is individualized and it's left for the physician's desire to decide upon which or what size should he initiate the trigger. So it is multifactorial. It is not just the size of the follicle, it is the size of the follicular cohort. It is the hormonal data on the day of trigger. It is the duration of stimulation. It is the burden and the financial cost of the, on the patient. And also in most centers, maturation is triggered at sizes of several leading follicles between 16 to 22. But the guideline developing group does not recommend to base timing of final cell maturation on estradiol. And also, we have discussed this earlier in this webinar, the days of stimulation could be important in some centers. And in low responders, it is advised to keep the days of stimulation short because afterwards, all the outcome increases. And in normal responders, you can extend the days of stimulation up to 9 days without compromising the outcome. Of course, this also is corrected with the size of the follicle. So it is not only the size of the leading follicle, it is the size of the cohort. So you try to make most of the follicles at the day of the trigger in the size of 12 to 19 millimeters. And the more you get follicles in this size, the better outcome that you have. If you left the leading follicle for long, they can result in post-mature oocytes and they can start in rising progesterone. So if the follicles reach 19, you have to think quickly of triggering final oocyte maturation. And as regards the number of embryos to transfer, the SRM, the recent SRM guidelines indicated that in patients over 38, three embryos, three blastocysts could be transferred if the patient was not a favorable patient that has a good criteria. And the vaginal ultrasound technique we have already mentioned. And this is the patient that has these parameters that we have discussed. So on day 9, one follicle was larger than 18, three follicles were 14 to 18, and the rest of the follicles were less than 14. And she was left for 1 day to increase the number of follicles in this green area. And at the day of the trigger, the LH was low, progesterone was low, and surprisingly, the estradiol was also low. This is the oocyte pickup. Washing of the oocytes. Anais. Chemical remover of the granulosa cells, and then mechanical removal of the granulosa cells gently. This is, should be a gentle and quick procedure, and this procedure should be done under oil. So four oocytes were retrieved, four intact, four in two, and the sperm was selected and immobilized. And we do this with triple technique on the outer third of the tail of the sperm, not near the neck of the sperm. And then the injection, and this is interesting, once the tenting occurs and the pipette is inside, we aspirate cytoplasm and inject. So three plus embryos were found on day two, and three plus embryos were found on day three. And the transfer was done as indicated before. We measure on the day of the transfer the length of the cervix from the external os to the internal os, and from the internal os to the tip of the endometrial stripe. The problem usually in this procedure is to find where the external os is, and so I have to do a lot of technique to see. This is measuring the cervix up to the internal os, and then measuring from the internal os to the tip of the endometrial stripe, and then subtracting 1.5 from these measures and putting the embryos safely into their place. If you notice here, after putting the embryos, they moved from this point up to the tip of the endometrium, so the distance became zero. And the patient was pregnant.
So very good. I think the endometrium is coming more thick at the time of transfer rather than the time of SG.
This was not compacted. If you mean compaction, it was not compacted.
Because I see that the measurement of the endometrium was less than 8 at day 9, yes?
This is very smart. Yes.
Yeah. You mentioned it, but at day 10, you didn't mention it was 10 days in between.
Yeah.
Okay. And so for my question, if you find the endometrium like that, so you trigger normally or you prefer to prolong? Because you finished at 10 days, so you prefer to prolong the protocol, or you don't like to intervention or freeze?
It's a very good question. The size of the follicles is limiting. So if the size of the follicles, if the size of the leading follicle was attained on day 8, you cannot wait for too long, even if you don't have a lot of follicles large in size.
Sure. Okay, and can I see the trigger? How did you trigger the patient? It is just 10,000 HCG.
HCG, yes.
In such patient, you don't prefer to trigger with more. No suggestions to trigger with more. Eh?
Than HCG, than 10,000?
Yes. No. No suggestion. No benefit. Okay. I think also in. Such patients, don't you prefer to have disease Poseidon group 2? Don't you prefer to start with higher dose?
It's also not a bad idea, but combining drugs can attain same goal.
Combining drugs in 3 amps per day?
Yeah.
Okay, so you don't see that it can you can have more outcome, better outcome if you have related with more amounts. for them?
The guidelines are 150 to 200 to 225. Maybe if you want to use 300 also fine, but she's not exactly a role responder.
So you started with 3. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Can we continue?
Yes. So the third patient is a case discussing recurrent myoma before ICSI, oral contraceptive pills before ICSI, and antagonist was used, starting with 3 amps of 225 of REC-FSH, and the criteria for HCG and the number of embryos transferred. So she was a recurrent myoma before ICSI, and oral pills were used before ICSI, as Velasco, Professor Velasco mentioned, and the starting dose was 225. And the data shows that subserosal fibroids are not removed except when they cause difficulties in ovarian retrieval. And the non-cavity distorting intramural fibroids prior to ICSI, the evidence currently suggests a detrimental effect. However, this is based on relatively low quality studies that show significant variability in selection criteria. So non-cavity distorting intramural myoma fibroids, the evidence for myomectomy is not strong evidence actually. It is likely that numbers needed to treat for this purpose for myomectomy in intramural myomas, not distorting the cavity, will be lower if the myoma was large. So it could be indicated if the myoma was large, but very high the number needed to treat if the myoma was small. An additional problem is that there is shortage of evidence regarding the benefit of removing non-cavity distorting intramural myomas. And also the morbidity have to be considered, because if you do this, you prolong the time to pregnancy and you may create other problems. So this is our case. Age 31, BMI 29. Match 3, anthropological count 9, primary 6 years. She did a myomectomy 3 years before. She has now a recurrent myoma, and the protocol selected was antagonist, and the cycle before we used the Inogest 2 mg and ethinyl estradiol 30 mg pills. The washout period was 5 days. And day 3, we began the stimulation with REC-FSH 225. And then on day 7, REC plus highly purified HMD.
Okay.
The sperm showed agglutination head to head, but we don't think that this has importance. On day 7, 5 follicles were 14 to 18, and 5 follicles were 10 to 14. So we waited more. And on day 10, 6 follicles were 18 or more, and 5 follicles were 14 to 18. And this was a good follicular distribution. And the hormones were favorable, LH 4.6, estrogen 2,500, and progesterone was low. Progesterone is always low when we use this protocol. 9 oocytes were retrieved. and they were injected. Again, quality of oocyte is good during injection, tenting and easy withdrawal of cytoplasm. And pregnancy with pulsation. And this is the myoma. That, of course, started some degeneration. And above the ulna, there is some small bleeding below the sac.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Professor Hassan, for this nice case. I just have an argument for the size of the myoma, because I think that if you have a myoma with 7 centimeters, which is subserous, it will cause a lot of disturbance during pregnancy. What do you see? What do you expect for a myoma before the start of pregnancy? It is 7 centimeters. Will it cause degeneration, pain? Maybe sometimes preterm labor, increased incidence of preterm labor, and sometimes some reported cases of incarceration. What do you think? The benefit of leaving it without removal?
It's a very good question, and it is actually, in all honesty, it is a good criticism. For me, it wasn't easy to determine whether this was distorting the cavity or not, despite doing 3D ultrasonography. And the size increased a little bit after a simulation, about 1.5 centimeter. I don't think there is a good literature about recurrent myoma and ICSI. The literature is concerned with the myoma and ICSI. And in fact, all patients who have large myoma were done. So all the literature is speaking about small myoma and ICSI. But yes. I searched the literature carefully. I couldn't see recurrent myoma and ICSI. So what do you think?
I agree, but I think there are some literature about the size of myoma and
the relation with preterm labor, but not recurrent.
But I think it will be somewhat harmful for the patient. And so for me, if it is 7 centimeter or more, I prefer to do before go to ICSI. Especially the reserve of this patient is good, so it will not affect ovarian reserve, because we know that myomectomy, in spite, we will not go to the ovarian reserve. The reports is also, we are afraid of affecting the reserve.
The point of good reserve is a good criticism, yes.
In such patients. So I prefer to make it more peaceful for the pregnancy for the patient. That's my opinion. But okay, so she got pregnant now, and so we hope it will go okay. And my second question, if you have a cavity touch in myoma, grade 3 myoma, some conflicting reports, some literature say that we should remove it, and some literature we should only remove it if there is a bad past history, bad obstetric history, bad recurrent failure, and also if the diameter touching this endometrium is 2 centimeters or more in a single diameter or collective diameters. How do you deal with grade 3 myoma?
I agree with all what you said, but in myoma, I am very conservative.
So if you find a grade 3 myoma in patients, whatever the size, you don't prefer to do, whether previous failure in ICSI?
No, previous failure, it will be done.
Okay.
Yes, previous failure, it will be done.
Okay. Yeah, another note about the protocol. Can you explain to the audience why you started with total FSH and then you go for one third of FSH and the other FNG?
We started with the pills, the Inogest and Ethinylestradiol Maltaviva for a month to synchronize the follicles and to decrease the potential inflammation in the myoma. We started with REC FSH Gonal 225 for 7 days. And after 7 days, all the functions of FSH can be done with LH actually. So if you use a product with LH activity and the granulosa cell is full of LH receptors, this results in a lowering the response, decreasing the estradiol, decreasing the incidence of HSS, and decreasing the incidence of high progesterone. Because as Velasco mentioned, FSH is a potent drug. So with potency, small follicles are recruited and the potential, the possibility of hyperstimulation is there. So if you start with FSH, with REC FSH, and then you switch off in the last 3 days of stimulation to highly purified HMG, I think you get the benefit of all.
Okay, very convincing solution. Thank you, Professor Hassan, and I think we have good lessons today from those cases.